Welcome sa ating CLJ Notes Channel. Pakisuportahan ang ating channel sa pamamagitan ng pag-like ng ating videos, pag-share nito sa ibang mga criminology students, at pag-subscribe na rin kung hindi ka pa subscribed. Ngayon, titingnan natin ang ating notes on rights of the accused sa Rule 115 ng ating Rules on Criminal Procedure. What are the rights of the accused at the trial? In all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall be entitled to the following rights. A. To be presumed innocent until the contrary is proved beyond reasonable doubt. So, ibig sabihin, hanggang hindi napapatunayan ng walang bahid ng duda ang guilt ng akusado, siya sa mata ng batas ay mananatiling inosente. Letter B. To be informed of the nature and cause of accusation against him. So, dapat alam niya kung ano ba ang charge or complaint or sakda laban sa kanya. Ito ay sa pamamagitan ng arraignment, kung saan formal niyang nalalaman kung ano talaga ang reklamo laban sa kanya. Sa preliminary investigation, pinapadalhan siya ng subpoena para alam niya kung ano ang dapat niyang sagutin. So, ito ay right to know the nature and cause of accusation against him. Letter C, to be present and defend in person and by counsel at every stage of the proceedings from arraignment to promulgation of judgment. So may karapatan na ng akusado na mag-attend sa bawat paglilitis, bawat yugto na kanyang paglilitis. Sa exclusion of witnesses, exempted ang akusado sa exclusion of witnesses kasi nga ang karapatan niya na maging present at ipagtanggol ang kanyang sarili ay mapapawalang bisa kapag e-exclude siya, kapag isa siya sa mga testigo. Letter D, to testify as a witness in his own behalf but subject to cross-examination on matters covered by direct examination. His silence shall not in any manner prejudice him. May karapatan siya magtestigo para sa kanyang sarili, pero kung hindi niya pipiliing magtestigo, ang kanyang pananahimik cannot be used against him. Letter E, to be exempt from being compelled to be a witness against him. Hindi siya pwedeng pilitin na maging testigo laban sa kanyang sarili. Ito yung tinatawag nating right against self-incrimination. Letter F, to confront and cross-examine the witnesses against him at the trial. So, kailangan makaharap niya at makross-examine through counsel ang kanyang mga testigo laban sa kanya. Letter G, to have compulsory process issued to secure the attendance of witnesses and production of other evidence in his behalf. So, meron siyang karapatan na mag-request ng compulsory process. Ito yung subpoena mula sa korte para obligahin ang testigo na magsalita para sa kanya o mag-produce ng evidence or documentary evidence pabor sa kanya. Letter H, to have speedy, impartial, and public trial. So, hindi pwede na usad-pagong ang paglilites, hindi pwede na ang huwes ay may kinikilingan, hindi pwede na private ang trial. Dapat isa publiko. And then, to appeal in all cases allowed and in the manner prescribed by law. So, meron din siyang karapatang mag-apila kapag binibigyan ng ganong karapatan ng batas. Ang presumption of innocence. The constitutional presumption of innocence can be accorded to the accused only in the absence of evidence to prove his guilt beyond reasonable doubt. So, nananatili ang presumption of innocence kapag walang proof beyond reasonable doubt against his guilt. That constitutional presumption cannot be upheld in the face of the overwhelming and incontrovertible evidence for the prosecution irresistibly pointing to the conclusive culpability of the accused. Pero kapag malinaw ang mga ebidensya na nagtuturo sa kanyang guilt, ibang usapan na yon. Ang guilt ay na-establish beyond reasonable doubt, wala na yung presumption of innocence. Presumption of guilt. The legislature has the power to provide that proof of certain facts can constitute prima facie evidence of the guilt of the accused and then shift the burden of proof to the accused provided there is a rational connection between the facts proved and the ultimate fact presumed. So, ang ibig sabihin, maaring magsabatas ng isang criminal law na nagsasabi na presumed guilty ang isang tao kapag na-prove ang isang bagay na walang ibang maaaring maging conclusion kung hindi ang kanyang guilt. Halimbawa, sa kaso ng compressor fishing, kapag ang isang tao ay mahulihan ng compressor paraphernalia sa kanyang bangka, ang presumption ay engaged siya sa compressor fishing. So, ang presumption ng guilt ng accused ay nakaangkla doon sa patunay na nakitaan ng compressor paraphernalia, ang mga breathing apparatus na ginagamit sa compressor fishing doon sa kanyang bangka. So, ang akusado ngayon ang merong obligasyon na patunayan na hindi siya engaged sa compressor fishing. Na halimbawa, yung compressor na yon ay gagamitin para sa dental work and so on. So, nag-shift ang burden of proof mula sa prosecution doon sa akusado. Proof beyond reasonable doubt does not mean such a degree of proof as excluding possibility of error produces absolute certainty. So, hindi naman ibig sabihin nun na absolute certainty ang proof beyond reasonable doubt. Moral certainty only is required or that degree of proof which produces conviction in an unprejudiced mind. So, ang proof beyond reasonable doubt ay hindi absolute certainty, moral certainty lang. Moral certainty means that degree of proof which to an unprejudiced mind produces conviction. So, yun ang moral certainty. That degree of proof which to an unprejudiced mind, ibig sabihin ang isipan na walang bias. And then, mag-produce siya ng conviction sa ganong pag-iisip. Reasonable doubt means that doubt engendered by an investigation of the whole proof and an inability after such investigation to let the mind rest each upon the certainty of guilt. So, yun yung reasonable doubt. Reasonable doubt. So, doubt na nagre-resulta doon sa investigasyon ng buong katotohanan, ng buong patunay. And then, pagkatapos ng nasabing investigation, hindi mapalagay ang isipan patungkol sa kasiguraduhan ng guilt. So, hindi siya convincing sa utak na guilt talaga ang isang akusado. So, yun ang reasonable doubt. So, ang kailangan ay proof beyond reasonable doubt. Kung may bahid ng duda, merong reasonable doubt, maaaring magresulta yon sa acquittal. The equipoise rule. So, ano naman ang equipoise rule? The equipoise rule provides that where the evidence in a criminal case is evenly balanced, the constitutional presumption of innocence tilts the scales in favor of the accused. So, ang sinasabi lang sa equipoise rule, equi, ibig sabihin equal ang standing ng ebidensya. So, pareho kabigat ang ebidensya ng prosecution at ng defense. So, ang mangyayari, mananatili ang presumption of innocence. So, maa-acquit ang akusado. What is the effect of the plea of self-defense? The burden of evidence is now shifted to the accused to prove such defense by clear, satisfactory, convincing evidence which shall exclude any vestige of criminal aggression on his part. Self-defense as justifying circumstance, it implies admission by the accused that he committed the criminal act. So, dahil inamin niya na ginawa niya ang criminal act na yon, patunayan niya na yon ay ginawa lamang niya dahil sa self-defense. So, nagkakaroon ng shift of burden of evidence from the prosecution to the accused. Right to be informed of the nature and cause of the accusation. Failure to do so, it would be a denial of accused appellant's basic right to due process. So, kapag hindi siya na-inform ng nature and cause of the accusation, may denial ng due process. Purpose, to inform the accused of the nature and cause of the accusation against him or the charge against him so as to enable him to prepare a suitable defense para malaman niya kung ano ang maaari niyang idepensa sa kanyang sarili. Kasi kung misinformed ka, maaaring maling ebidensya rin ang maipipresent mo. RA 7438. It is an act of defining certain rights of person arrested, detained, or under custodial investigation, as well as the duties of the arresting officers, detaining and investigating officers, and providing penalties for violations thereof. So yung Republic Act 7438, ito yung batas na nagsasaad ng mga karapatan ng mga taong na aresto, na detine, or under investigation, custodial investigation, at ang mga duties ng mga arresting officers, detaining officers, investigating officers, at yung mga parusa kaugnay ng mga violations na yon. Does one need to be an accused to avail of the right to counsel? No. The right to counsel does not commence only during trial. Every person under custody of the law enjoys the right. Republic Act 7438 Section 2 provides that any person arrested, detained, or under custodial investigation shall at all times be assisted by counsel. So hindi kailangang akusado ka. The fact na under custodial investigation ka, target ka ng criminal investigation for a commission of the crime, meron ka ng right to counsel. What is police lineup? A process consists of placing a criminal suspect in a group of other individuals who had nothing to do with the crime. The eyewitness is tasked with the responsibility of identifying the suspect. One way to perform this is to have the eyewitness identify a suspect during a live lineup. This process usually involves having the suspect and four or five other people line up against a wall. So yun yung police lineup. Ihahalo doon sa mga hindi sinususpetsahan ng mga tao ang isang suspect at i-identify siya ng eyewitness or eyewitnesses. Usually, ang isa ihahalo sa 4 hanggang 5 tao. Photo lineup naman, present the eyewitnesses with a series of pictures which typically includes 6 or more photos. So yun yung photo lineup. So ang kaibahan lang, syempre photo, picture. Yung lineup talaga, yung police lineup talaga, yung mga tao mismo naka-line facing the wall, di ba? Or minsan one-way glass or mirror. Does the right to counsel apply in a mere police lineup? No. Unless if the police investigation is no longer a general inquiry. When it began to focus on a particular suspect and the police starts the interrogation and propounds questions to the person to elicit incriminatory statements. So kung police lineup lang, wala pa namang particular inquiry or general inquiry pa lang naman sa kung sino ang posibleng gumawa ng krimen, hindi pa available ang right to counsel. Pero once na pinpointed na ang isang tao and then may mga interrogatory questions na, may mga tanong na yung peace officers, the right to counsel will step in. What is custodial investigation? The stage where the police investigation is no longer a general inquiry into an unsolved crime but has begun to focus on a particular suspect taken into custody by the police who carry out a process of interrogation that lends itself to elicit incriminating statements. It involves any questioning initiated by law enforcement officers after a person has been taken into custody or otherwise deprived of his freedom of action in any significant way. So yun yung custodial investigation. Yung meron ng specific person in mind ang mga investigating police officers as target of investigation, as target of possible filing of a case. When does the rule begin to operate? It is only after the investigation ceases to be a general inquiry into an unsolved crime and begins to focus on a particular suspect, the suspect is taken into custody, and the police carries out a process of interrogations that lend itself to eliciting incriminating statements. So doon, nagsisimula na ang custodial investigation. What are the requisites for an extrajudicial confession to be admissible? So para daw admissible ang extrajudicial confession. Ang ibig sabihin ng extrajudicial confession, ito yung pag-amin na ginawa sa labas ng hukuman. Kasi yung judicial confession, doon mismo yun sa korte ginagawa. Paglabas ng korte, extrajudicial confession. So admissible ang extrajudicial confession kapag the confession is voluntary. The confession must be voluntary. B, the confession must be made with the assistance of competent and independent counsel, preferably of the confessant's choice. So, dapat meron siyang legal assistance ng abogado, competent na abogado. Now, letter C, the confession must be express, malinaw. And letter D, the confession must be in writing, dapat nakasulat. As outside of this, hindi maaaring tanggapin ang extrajudicial confession. Assuming that all constitutional and statutory safeguards have been complied with, an extrajudicial confession made by an accused shall not be sufficient ground for conviction unless corroborated by evidence of corpus delicti. Pero kahit meron extrajudicial confession, kung walang corroboration of evidence ng corpus delicti, yung fact of the commission of the crime, ibig sabihin, kahit na inamin mo yan, kung ang available evidence hindi naman nagtuturo sa iyo as a guilty party, hindi pa rin yan uubra. Kasi nga, may mga pagkakataon na yung ibang tao aaminin nila yung isang crime na hindi naman sila ang gumawa. So, hindi maaaring gawin yan. Pwedeng gawin yan, pero hindi uubra ang ganong sistema. Kasi nga, kailangan pa rin ng additional corroborative evidence ng corpus delicti, yung body of the crime. Right to speedy disposition of cases. To assure that an innocent person may be free from the anxiety and expense of a court litigation, or if otherwise, of having his guilt determined within the shortest possible time, compatible with the presentation and consideration of whatsoever legitimate defense he may interpose. So, yun yung right to speedy disposition of cases. Dapat, yung nililitis na kaso ay matapos within the shortest possible time. Okay, para naman hindi siya mag-drag ng sobrang tagal, masyado ng oppressive sa akusado. The right to a speedy disposition of a case, like the right to speedy trial, is deemed violated only when, so na-violate ang right to speedy disposition of a case kapag the proceedings are attended by vexatious, capricious, and oppressive delay. So kakainis, okay, capricious, it depends on the whims and caprices, no? And oppressive delays when unjustified postponements of the trial are asked for and secured. So, hindi justified ang postponement. Halimbawa, Your Honor, may we ask for the postponement of the assignment of the case today because so and so, because the counsel failed to take his lunch at McDonald's. Eh, naku naman, no? So, unjustified na yung mga ganun. Hindi naman ganun kababaw lang na reason. So, halimbawa, the counsel failed to read the counter affidavit of the accused. Yung mga ganung bagay na kapabayaan na nila, tapos magsasuffer ang akusado ng delay. When without cause or justifiable motive, a long period of time is allowed to elapse without the party having his case tried. So, nakabinbin lang ang kaso, hindi naman dininig ng hukuman. So, that will be violation of a speedy disposition of a case already. State the scope of the privilege against self-incrimination. Di ba kanina nabanggit natin, hindi pwedeng pilitin o obligahin ng isang tao magtestigo laban sa kanyang sarili. Ang kanyang silence will not be interpreted against him. So it only protects from testimonial compulsion or is compelled or in compelled testimony of communicative nature. So nag-a-apply lang siya sa testimonial compulsion or communicative nature na testimony. Hindi siya nag-a-apply sa halimbawa pagkuha ng blood sample, pagkuha ng semen sample and so on. Yung halimbawa, titingnan kung may nunal siya sa ganito, di ba may case ng isang rape na may isang rape victim na sinabi niya na makikilala ko siya kasi okay, nung ginalaw niya ako, nung ni-rape niya ako, nakita ko may nunal siya sa dulo ng kanyang ari. So, kung i-ocular inspection yun, i-inspection niya ng kanyang ari at may nunal nga, nagsasabi ng totoo ang biktima. Will the privilege apply when witnesses given immunity from prosecution? No. Under American common law, a witness may be immunized from prosecution. Immunity from prosecution occurs when the government under an authorizing law grants immunity to a witness in exchange for a testimony favorable to the prosecution. This immunity embodies an understanding that the prosecutor essentially agrees to refrain from prosecuting the witness. So ito yung tinatawag din natin sa atin na state witness. So meron siyang immunity from suit in the future based on the same evidence or set of facts. What are the forms of immunity from prosecution? The government may grant immunity in one of the following two forms. Yung tinatawag natin transactional immunity, also known as blanket or total immunity, completely protects the witness from future prosecution for crimes related to his or her testimony. This is broader in scope. This is broader in the scope of its protection. So yun yung transactional immunity. Immune ka na or meron ka ng blanket or total immunity na kasuhan sa related na kaso doon sa kung saan magtetestigo ka. Use and derivative use immunity prevents the prosecution only from using the witness's own testimony or any evidence derived from the testimony against the witness. A witness is only assured that his or her particular testimony and evidence derived from it will not be used against him or her in a subsequent prosecution. So sa use and derivative use, ang immunity na paugnay lang doon sa testimony ng witness. Hindi necessarily sa pag-absuelto or paglagay sa kanya sa immunity ng lahat ng kaugnay na reklamo kaugnay doon sa kasong nililitis. However, should the prosecutor later on acquire evidence of a crime committed by the witness, independently of the witness testimony, the witness may then be prosecuted for the crime. So, yun na yung mga caveat dito o yun ang dapat pantayan. Kasi kapag halimbawa, nagtestigo siya, nagkaroon siya ng use and derivative use immunity, pero later on, merong mga independent evidence of a crime committed by the witness liban doon sa mga sinasabi niya sa testimony niya as state witness, maaari siyang makasuhan based doon sa ibang evidence na yon. Discuss the right of the accused to defend himself, right to be present at trial, and right to be heard. An accused is accorded the right to defend himself either in person or by counsel. As a consequence of such right, he has the right to be present at the trial at every stage of the proceedings from arraignment to the promulgation of the judgment. So dapat, simula doon sa arraignment niya hanggang promulgation of judgment, andun siya kung gugustuhin niya. Pwede naman niyang i-waive yun. Discuss the right to testify as a witness. The accused has the right to testify as a witness in his own behalf, but subject to cross-examination on matters covered by the direct examination. The question that may be asked to the accused in a cross-examination is limited to the matters covered by the direct examination. This is in contrast to the much wider scope of the cross-examination of an ordinary witness who is not the accused. So magkaiba yung scope or coverage ng cross-examination questions nung accused mismo kaysa sa ibang testigo or witnesses. Kasi sa ibang witnesses, ang sinusunod na natin na patakaran na yung open wide rule ng British, hindi yung limited to the direct examination lang. Dito naman sa accused, nananatili pa rin yung cross-examination based doon lang sa kanyang direct examination. Discuss the right to confront and cross-examine the witnesses against him. The cross-examination of a witness is essential to test his or her accuracy, expose falsehoods or half-truths, uncover the truth which rehearsed direct examination testimonies may successfully suppress, and demonstrate inconsistencies in substantial matters which create reasonable doubt as to the guilt of the accused, and thus give substance to the constitutional right of the accused to confront the witnesses against him. So, yung right to confront and cross-examination ng accused is a way by which matitest niya kung gaano ba ka panipaniwala, gaano ka credible ang sinasabi ng testigo during the direct examination. Kasi sa direct examination, maano lang yun, ma-smooth sailing lang yung pagtatanong. Kasi nga, yung nagtatanong doon, yung abogado ng party na nagpe-present ng witness na yon. So hindi siya tinatawag natin na hindi siya kontrapartido, no? So There is no antagonism. Hindi tulad ng cross-examination na merong antagonistic na stance, no? Discuss the right to compulsory process. This right may be invoked by the accused to secure the attendance of witnesses and production of witnesses in his behalf. In connection with his right, the accused may move the court for the issuance of subpoena ad testificandum or a subpoena duces tecum pursuant to the provisions of Rule 21 of the Rules of Court. So, dalawa. So, subpoena ad testificandum, ito yung patawag para magtestigo, or subpoena duces tecum para i-produce ang certain documents. Or pwedeng subpoena ad testificandum duces tecum. So, you are going to appear to testify and produce documents. In case of the unjustified failure of the witness to comply, the court or judge issuing the subpoena upon proof of the service of such subpoena and proof of his failure to attend may issue a warrant for his arrest. So, pwede siyang ipa-bench warrant ng judge for contempt of court kasi hindi niya sinunod ang patawag para sa kanya na magtestigo. Discuss the right to appeal. In all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall have the right to appeal in the manner prescribed by law. It affords litigants ampliest opportunity for the proper and just disposition of his case, freed from constraints of technicality. So, yung right to appeal. Merong rules na sinusunod. Usually, ang right to appeal is to be exercised within 15 days from the promulgation of judgment, no, to the higher court. So, kapag galing ng municipal trial court, iaapila sa regional trial court, iaapila sa Court of Appeals, and then finally sa Supreme Court. Right? So, yun yung mga mahalagang puntos regarding the rights of the accused na napapaloob sa Rule 115. Arali ng mabuti ang notes para makatulong sa inyong board examination sa hinaharap. Keep on studying and keep on pursuing your dream. I'm hoping that each one of you will be successful. You will be one of the future criminologists of our country and be part of our law enforcement. God bless everyone. Stay safe.